it's overwhelming, but it's also our jobs.
Our job is only going to get harder.
It's worrisome.
This is something that's unprecedented.
Now is not the time to be a cowboy. No one has anything to prove. We're all in this together.
Welcome to Reporting from the Frontline of a Pandemic. I'm Isha Marate, and I'm here with two-time New England Emmy Award-winning former executive producer and reporter Joe Rocco. He is now leading his own production company, Rock Joe Productions. Thank you, Joe, for joining me.
Hello, Isha. Pleasure.
Pleasure on this end as well. Can we just start out with you talking a little bit about what you do and what your production company does? Just tell people.
Rock Joe Productions, which I started in 1995, is a video and television production company, and we produce videos and television mostly for the corporate world, promotional videos, television commercials, and once in a while a documentary. And also, as a sidebar to that, which I got into by accident, some event coordination, coordinating mostly high profile events, banquets honoring prominent people, and some actually stand up comedy shows. So that is Rock Joe Productions.
Right. And how did you get into that from such a long career in reporting?
The video production part of it was kind of a natural transition after 12 years or actually 16 years as a sports anchor reporter. I had a desire to get out of the television news business in the late 90s, work for myself. I had some of my friends in business that would ask me if I could produce a promotional video for their company. I either didn't have the time or the permission from the television station I was working at to be able to do that, but I always had that in the back of my mind that may be the next thing to do in my life if and when I was through with the television news business. And so that has allowed me to put together a pretty good living over the years and do a variety of videos from and getting to know, after most of my life was chasing and running around athletes and coaches in arenas and airports and stadiums, which was a lot of fun and a great way to make a living, I've gotten to learn a lot about what certain companies do. You know, you drive by buildings, which you probably do every day. You don't even know what's going on in there, whether it's manufacturing or technology, whatever it happens to be. So I've gotten to do a lot of those videos and learned a lot along the way besides making a living. And then the event side of the thing is a long story, but it's also something that I've enjoyed doing, and it makes either or not boring. It's good not to be doing video production all the time and not doing events all the time. So a little variety, but always being careful not to try to do too much at once, because then after a while you don't do anything well. So you have to balance that.
Do you miss reporting at all, being in the studio, you know, being a part of a news station?
What I miss, unfortunately, and I say this a little reluctant to tell you, an aspiring reporter anchor, is that what you'd like to do maybe? Okay, so don't take this the wrong way, but what I miss for the most part doesn't exist anymore. The resources and the commitment that most television stations used to have, as I'm sure you're aware, is very different today than even 10 years ago, never mind 20 years ago. And I came along at a time and worked for some stations where we had the commitment and the resources and the high standards to do it right. And then when some of those things get taken away after a while, it's just not as rewarding or not as fun. And I always believe in, besides making a living, you have to have fun. And what I saw, what I was experiencing at my station, and what I was talking to colleagues in bigger markets and smaller markets, most of those people were not very happy. So I had to make a decision whether to try to maybe go somewhere else where it might be better, but I was seeing that it really wasn't better. Mm-hmm. And I do miss how it used to be. And I'm not saying that's everywhere. There's like in Boston, there's been some slippage, but not as much or not nearly as much, because as you probably know, Boston's always had a tremendously higher standard than most of the rest of the country. Boston has a great reputation, as you probably know, for doing television news at the highest levels. And yes, they've slipped too. And I'm sure if you talk to veteran Boston reporters and producers, and maybe you already have, they will tell you it's not the same. However, I think the Boston market is very lucky that, you know, channels 4 and 5 and 7 still do a great job in how they cover news. There's a major slippage when you go to even media markets like Providence and middle-sized markets in the 40s and 50s. Mm-hmm. And so, yeah, what I miss really doesn't exist anymore. And but although I shouldn't say, you know, I covered in Providence, we covered the Rhode Island sports scene and the Boston sports scene. So I came along at a great time, not like the recent 20-year run we've had, but, you know, the Red Sox were successful for the first time in a long time, and the Patriots went to their first Super Bowl ever. They lost it, but it was still very exciting, first time ever. So I got to cover a lot of those things. And yes, it's a lot of work, and it was a lot of fun. If I could go, I guess, for a week, just jump back in and cover a World Series or a Super Bowl, as much work as that is, yeah, I would still do that, happily do that. But the rest of the time, maybe too much of an uphill struggle for me.
No, thank you for your honesty. And, you know, certainly something I have heard from veteran reporters, both in print and in broadcast, you know, on both sides. A question about your production company. So has it affected you at all and your work that you're doing at your production company, the whole pandemic quarantine issue?
Certainly it has. You know, we were supposed to be doing some videos for a major banquet down here for to honor various prominent individuals in Rhode Island. And we were supposed to do 8 videos for that event, which has been postponed to the fall, September. Hopefully it happens in September. But that was a major project. There was one other in the works, not a done deal yet, but 60/40 was going to happen. Obviously, that's on hold, as most of the world is on hold. On the events side of things, partnering with the Comedy Connection in Providence, Rhode Island, we do something called the South Coast Comedy Series, which was going to be 6 shows at a facility in Westport, Massachusetts, between Fall River and New Bedford. We got one of the shows in February, which went well and was great. We have 5 more scheduled. We have postponed or canceled 4 of them. There's a 6th scheduled for May 30th, which we're most likely going to have to postpone or cancel. So we're trying to move all those to the fall, keep our fingers crossed, be optimistic that we can pull those off in the fall. But the challenge has been all of these comedians, all the talent obviously is getting pushed back. Everybody's pushed, you know, there's many more people than me doing this. Plus, at the facility where we do these shows, it's a popular banquet facility. So dozens of banquets, weddings, parties have been postponed to the fall. So trying to get the comedians' availability, and these are nationally known popular comedians, some of them household names, coupled up with when the banquet facility has available space, and we don't want to be doing shows on a Monday or Tuesday night, if you know what I mean. We're looking for Fridays and Saturdays. Has been more than a challenge. We've been able to schedule 2 of the 5, and we're working on the other 3. And in fact, on Monday, we've come to the conclusion, talking with my partners, we might even have to look for other facilities, even though that might create a little bit of confusion. If we're really clear in our advertising and online and our website that this show is here and this show is there, it's all, you know, within a 20-mile radius. If we are successful, hopefully people won't go to the wrong venue. So that's a little bit of a nutshell of how things in my little world have changed.
So it is still, it sounds to me like, though a very different job, you know, so to speak, from reporting, there is that element still of kind of uncertainty and things changing and planning and collaboration that comes, you know, with being in a newsroom, at least from, you know, I haven't worked in one yet, but have only interned. So, you know, it sounds to me like there are some skills for sure that, you know, you probably had as a reporter that you're using in this work. Do you agree with that?
Well, that's a very good question. And yes, and as I tell on the video side of things, prospective clients, that little did I know that collecting all of this sports information and video throughout the day to get it down to 3.5 minutes for the 6 o'clock news, little did I know that was great training for what I do now, to take a company's 7-page brochure that unfortunately, because people don't read as much as they used to, so most people probably are not going to read that brochure, but they probably will watch a 2-minute video. So taking all of that information, plus information I might get by interviewing the CEO, the manager, the employees, and having maybe an hour of video and getting that down to 2 minutes, well, that's, again, what I did for 16 years, deciding what's in the newscast or the sportscast, what's not, what to use, what not to use. And then, of course, when you apply the skills of what is good video and good writing, you know, something I'm sure you've heard and you probably know, if you can write well for news, you can write well for sports, you can write, it's all the same principles and skills. So being able to write a concise, engaging sports feature story was great. You know, having done that, never really counted, but probably 1,500 times, 2,000 times, was tremendous training, which has helped me now write a piece. The last video we just did was for a health and wellness yoga facility, and needed to write a couple of 90-second feature stories on the food they offer there, the healthy food they offer there, and then part of their facility, which is called Urban Sweat. And take all this information, and we actually shot 4 hours of video and get it down to 2 90-second videos. It was fairly easy for me to do. And it's also helped distinguish me from other people out there in my area, the competition, so to speak. Not that I'm the only one, certainly, who does it well, because there's many. But having that training, again, and that discipline that, you know, you got to get all this stuff in 3 minutes or 4 minutes. And you'll experience it that someday, and you're experiencing it now, was just great training in helping me what we do. And then the other side of the thing is, and this is where the stress comes in being a television news anchor or reporter, as I still tell people sometimes, that's an occupation, and maybe you've thought about this, unlike 99% of occupations out there where you, if you're doing a live shot or you need to be on the set or get your package in time, you have a hard deadline like 99% of the people in America, including probably brain surgeons, don't have. The brain surgeon starts his, unless it's emergency surgery, and a minute or two late or 10 minutes late, it's probably no big deal. You can't tell the news director, it's when the light came on at 6:20 to do sports, I'm not ready, I need another minute or two. That might be the end of your career. So learning how to budget your time properly and get things done when you have a hard deadline, no exceptions, that was great training too, which I now apply to my business and getting things done. So I kind of chuckle sometimes when a company says, and I'll say, well, when do you need this video? And they say, well, you know, I don't know if this is too quick, but, you know, we really need it in 3 or 4 weeks. Without being too cocky, I try to tell them, look, we could shoot it tomorrow, you know, and get it to you by 10 o'clock at night so that's all, that's kind of interesting and helpful coming from that world. But that obviously creates a tremendous amount of stress. You know, now I guess once in a while, if you're a reporter package and they could float your package and run it a little later in the newscast, I mean, not total life and death, even though you don't want to be in that situation. But, you know, you think about that for a second. You know, unless you're an air traffic controller bringing in a plane or emergency medicine where someone's dying, the other 99% of the occupations, you can get it done when you get it done for the most part.
I guess a good, you know, good transition into this conversation might be, right now at our age, when we're graduating in this extremely unprecedented sort of a time, it feels like, you know, and everyone's kind of freaking out and saying, well, like, I wanted to be this, I wanted to be that. Now I don't know what's going to happen. Are there going to be jobs? What can you offer as someone who has done it and has been like, look, I moved on and I have skills that I acquired from this lifetime that I'm using in this other one?
Well, like for every patience, and I know most people, maybe millennials more than others. It's tough to just be patient. That's what I think everybody's going to need to be, because this is, unless there's a miracle vaccine or at the very least cure coming down the pike real soon, which unfortunately does not appear to be the case, everybody's going to have to be patient. And for you and your fellow students, I think it's important to remember, yes, there'll always be lots of jobs out there. And that's, you know, the pause, I gave you kind of a little bit of the negative of how the business has changed and not for the better. But here's the positive side where it has changed for the better. There's more jobs now for you and your fellow students than ever. And, you know, when we graduated in 1981, believe it or not, you know, there wasn't even ESPN, I don't think. Or they were just starting. I mean, there were very, very few jobs. There was no internet, which I'm sure you'd find very hard to believe. But so there's more jobs than ever. So even though maybe the standards and the commitment and the resources aren't there that used to be there in the 80s and 90s and early 2000s even, I think you can find a little comfort in knowing there's never been more jobs than ever. People are always going to want to be informed. We will obviously get behind that, be away over this, and we will get back to a near normal and then a normal. Mm-hmm. And just look what you're doing right now and what you're seeing reporters do and shows. I mean, so much of it is virtual. Mm-hmm. And I know that's going to be, and probably still is, a tough adjustment to make, that you can't go out in the field. Although you're seeing reporters do it all the time. I was talking to another Emerson guy, used to be our news director, actually. Who's a Boston guy in various businesses. And he gave a news director friend advice about a month ago. She was in a market in Michigan somewhere. And he told her to, right now, this is early March, to go out and buy like yardsticks and tape microphones on those yardsticks so your reporters can stay 3 or 4 feet away. And you're seeing it now when you see the news anyway. You're seeing most reports, you know, with the mic sticks and the extensions and things. So for a while, that's what you're going to have to get used to doing, but the news will never stop and you're always going to be in need and there's more jobs than ever. And I think those, you've probably heard this already, but if you're aggressive and you politely drip on people to get those jobs, because I remember when I graduated, now I got to get a job. And it was tougher then because, again, there were many, many fewer opportunities. Most markets only had 3 stations. You know, there was no Fox News. There was no independent news. There was none of that. And yeah, there were still 211 television markets. I don't know if it's still 211, but I brought roughly that. Mm-hmm. But believe me, I wasn't the best looking, best sounding guy. I left Emerson with a pretty good tape. And I just got it out there and I was just persistent, and you got to help yourself to be in the right place at the right time. But if you do that, you'll be fine and you'll get a job, and then you just have to work on continuing to improve as you go along the way. Never be satisfied for where you're at. Just continue to improve and politely drip on people. Somewhere between becoming annoying and once in a while, you know, to get that next job to that next level. And you know what will help you too is, I know I always watch back every one of my air checks, every night. Whether it was midnight, we had a long day and you're exhausted, took 3-4 minutes to watch it back. And when I'd put a new resume back then tape, when I put a new resume tape together every 6 months, 8 months, a year, it felt good for me to be able to see and recognize that I was getting better. The writing was getting a little better. I was getting a little more polished. Whatever you've done now at Emerson, it's probably pretty good because you're getting a great education. You're at a great school. And I'm assuming you're working hard and you've done what you've done. And you probably think right now what you've done is pretty good. And it is for where you're at. You always got to remember, try to measure yourself for where you're at right now versus someone that maybe you look up to or watch often on TV that you'd like to be that person. Someone, an Emerson instructor, gave me that advice once. So obviously you're not going to be you're far away, you're leaps and bounds from Nora O'Donnell, I'm guessing, okay, or Savannah Guthrie, or whoever you like and watch, or Gail King. But try to measure yourself against, you know, your fellow students and what else is out there. And if you can be right there near the top in that area. That's where you are right now. But at the very top is your Gail King, your Savannah Guthrie, your Hoda Kotb, whatever. That's where you want to get to. And as you see yourself go up the ladder and get closer to those polished professionals, the best in the business, you'll feel really good about going through your career and getting to the next level, especially if you're in some small market making little to no money and you're saying, oh, I don't know if I can do this another week. But when you go back and watch the tape and you see the improvement and know with confidence that you can climb that ladder, when we get past all of this, which we will, I think that'll help you feel much, much better as you go through your journey and get on the Today Show set.
What have you seen in terms of the reporting on this pandemic that, you know, you think this could have been done better 20 years ago? We would have done this differently. It would have informed people better. Or do you think you've been surprised by how good a job people are doing, or both?
Yeah, I'm down here in Southern Massachusetts, and we watch mostly the Boston TV, and we can watch Providence TV. I think the people who are doing the reporting now are super courageous. They're probably working harder than ever. We used to see that even as our standards diminished at the station I worked at in Providence, still on like election night or major storms, the station, the news directors somehow found the money and resources to go cover it well. And obviously they're battling budgets and higher ups, and that's another story. But so from what I'm seeing right now, I think the reporting has been excellent at all levels. And I think that's the nature of the news business. That actually is refreshing to see that it's still there, that when the, you know what hits the fan, news stations and networks will rally and pull out all the stops. Even if it's probably, you know, there's probably a lot of news directors and general managers out there sweating out their budgets, but they're covering it, and they're covering it well, even in the Providence market. And again, there's leap year from Providence to Boston, and it's always been that way. But Boston's a much bigger market with bigger budgets. What's refreshing to see, and I was having the discussion again with former news director I was telling you about a few minutes ago, who had the yardstick idea. We were talking a few weeks ago, and he said, at least as far as we know, we haven't seen on a national basis, Chris Cuomo, but say the Boston market. And I read the Boston Globe every day, and I'm tuned in to the Boston stations. I haven't seen a local news reporter or anchor come down with the virus, and maybe I missed it. I don't know. Have you heard of any?
I've only heard of them, but only through Marsha or other people, but not actually by watching them, no.
Yeah, well, it's amazing. I know they're probably taking all the precautions necessary, but in a newsroom environment, as you know, and, you know, newsrooms are still, especially in the Boston market, and even Providence, there's still a lot of people working there. And they're in and out of edit rooms, or editing remotely. I mean, I don't know. I haven't been in the newsroom, but it is good to see that none have come down with the virus as far as I know.
Right.
So I mean, again, but all in all, I think the reporting's has been excellent, and I really admire the people out there still doing it.
Right.
I'm actually glad I'm not doing it.
Are you?
So I have time to talk to you and catch up on Netflix stuff and read some books.
Thank you, Joe, for taking the time to talk to me, and thank you for all the work that you have done in the past for keeping us informed. And thank you to all of you for watching this episode of Reporting from the Frontline of a Pandemic. I've been talking with Joe Rocco from Rock Joe Productions.